Okay. Well, there might be some more still to join us, but I'd like to give you all a very warm welcome this afternoon to Harmony House and to our Trust and Community Cohesion afternoon. My name is Tim Fawcett. I am with a project called The Feast, which I'll explain later, and I am very privileged to be your host for this afternoon and to introduce you to a number of presentations and hopefully an opportunity for you to both hear some information around our topic of discussion but also to engage in it. And we'd very much like to hear from you at a point later in our afternoon. But can I first of all introduce the organising committee who have put this afternoon on? Firstly, we have Dr. Alison Tyson, who's just to my left. Alison is a PhD supervisor and program leader in the Master of Science in Educational Leadership at the University of Leicester School of Education. She has been instrumental in putting together the panel of speakers that you are going to hear from this afternoon. And this is a mouthful for those of you who don't know much about it. I'll give you it's called BELMAS, but it stands for the British Educational Leadership Management and Administrative Society. There's a test for you later this afternoon to see if you remember what BELMAS stands for. They're one of the sponsors of today's program. Second, we have Bhupen Patel, is the coordinator of Harmony House, which we're currently in. He has very generously provided the venue, the publicity, the technical support, and the speaker's lunch, all free of charge. And I would like you to give him a round of applause for that kindness for this day. We'll meet Bhupen in a moment. And finally, we have Mr. Shailen Poppet, who had the idea of getting the academics into community settings where conversations can take place. So he's been a major driver of today's event. I'd like to give him a round of applause for the vision for today. The schedule for today is that we'll listen to a number of short presentations. They'll be from some of the panellists here, and we also have a guest who has gotten up early in Chicago, who will be speaking to us through Skype. So there's going to be a spiritual reflection from Sister Indu, and followed by a discussion where we'll all like to participate. But first I'd like to invite Bhupen, who would like to welcome you to Harmony House and say a few words.
Hello everyone, I'm Shanti and welcome, greetings of peace. We're really honored to have all of you here and our guest speakers. This is the first time we're actually trying this kind of event. And I'm sure it's going to be wonderful and people's going to take away a lot of benefit from it. Before we begin, I think as always, you know, we have to have safety rules of the house. So really, in case of emergency or you know, if we are asked to evacuate the building, we have four fire exit doors, two at this side and two at the back. And the ushers will guide you in case of emergency. But really, what I want to say is, you know, I'm not the only person who's actually have you know, helping to organize this event. There's so many others involved, you know, because Harmony House, as you can see, it's been acquired, and now we're actually now finishing 2 years of this building. You know, we used to be sort of, we started off 40 years ago in a very small house in Leicester, and and you can see how we have evolved from there. And since then, we've been really working with community, all sorts of people, you know, all sorts of background. So it's really, that's what we are about, you know. And one of the things that we really sort of promote is self-development and spirituality, how to bring about the balance in everyday life, because we are actually, you know, in the society where we are facing challenges in every corner, you know, everything, in, whether it's in the house, you know, whether at the workplace, you know, you name it, you know. But really, you know, what we sort of offered here is actually helps people to sort of live their life. You know, so really, I hope you'll enjoy you know, this afternoon event. So I'll come back later on. Thank you so much.
Bye. So please do, if you're a guest, first time visit to Harmony House, please do have a look around and speak to Bhupen. It is an amazing facility that he very kindly gave us a tour of earlier. First of all, now we get to hear from our esteemed presenters. And our first presenter is Shailen, who's over here. Now, I have a little spiel on Shailen. You have to take... those of you who aren't academics, and myself and Rich here are the two non-academics on stage, and we've been jesting with our university colleagues about understanding certain terminology. So I'll read this spiel that he's given me, and hopefully it makes sense to us all. But these are wonderful people thinking about the topic that we have today, and they've got some wonderful things to share. So Shailen is a former senior practitioner for Warwickshire County Council Children and Young People Services, and in 2008 he founded a project called Realise, which served hundreds of children in Rugby Borough and Daventry District. His work was recognised at the Northamptonshire Education Awards and also at the Pride of Northamptonshire Awards of 2015. He is commencing a DPhil in Education at the University of Oxford and is both a BK... I should have checked what BK... a mediator and member of Belmas. So over to you, Shailen.
Thank you, Tim. So there's going to be a series of slides which I invite you to follow while I read through it. My talk today is going to be along the lines of authentic leadership and community cohesion. The three things that I'd like to propose correlate are authentic leadership, the capital of psychological trust, and then how that leads to community cohesion. So connecting the three together. My first arguments are schools, in particular, being an educationalist, centres of the community, have a duty to promote community cohesion. They will only be able to do so when both school leaders and community leaders create an atmosphere of trust and camaraderie. It is argued that such an atmosphere is dependent upon the style of leadership provided, as members of a community reciprocate. In order for the reciprocation to be constructive, positive psychological capital must be accumulated. So it's not just telling people what to do, but the whole group must feel within themselves that they wish to do it. This is supported by social exchange theory, which suggests that people define themselves in terms of whom they interact with and how they interact with them. We're not islands on our own. We feel about ourselves according to our interactions. Thus, it is argued that when leaders are in a positive social exchange relationship, followers often go beyond their formal duties. That's meant to be duties there, apologies. So then, what is the definition of community cohesion that I'm using? And I've taken this from the government definition in 2009. There are many definitions, but I enjoyed this one from the Department of Communities. So this is John Denham. Strong and inclusive communities underpinned by shared values and based on positive relationships and mutual respect are the building blocks of a fair and stable society. No matter what our background, religion, or political persuasion, we all share some fundamental values, foremost among them being respect for the law, tolerance, and freedom of speech. By reinforcing those common values, by supporting chances for people to come together, learn more about each other and overcome misperceptions, we can reinforce those shared values and strengthen our communities. So then what do I mean by authentic leadership? Well, authentic leaders are said to act in accordance with fundamental and deeply rooted values and beliefs, rather than just responding to external pressures or narrow and transitory interests. It has been suggested that authentic leaders value realistic and truthful relationships with followers, and so interact with openness and truthfulness, which is then reciprocated. So how the leader behaves, it then comes back to the leader. Some researchers have found that the key characteristics of authentic leaders are that they exhibit a pattern of openness and clarity in their behavior towards others shared by sharing the information needed to make decisions, accept others' inputs, and provide constructive feedback to their followers. As a result, followers tend to be more efficacious, hopeful, optimistic, and resilient, and are more trusting, consequently facilitating high levels of effective behaviors. Authentic leadership has been thus defined as a pattern of leader behavior that draws upon and promotes both positive psychological capacities and also a positive ethical climate. So it's the atmosphere that matters as much as the relationship. To foster greater self-awareness, an internalized moral perspective, balanced processing of information and relational transparency on the part of leaders working with followers, fostering positive self-development. So what does that mean? The first quality of an authentic leader, balanced processing. Balanced processing refers to a leader behavior that is less susceptible to denials, distortions, and exaggerations. So they're more interested in what is really happening rather than gossip and imagination and so on. Secondly, an authentic leader will have internalized moral perspective. And that means that they're guided by an internal moral standard as opposed to those behaviors based on external pressures from peers and other organizational demands. Third quality, relational transparency, which refers to leader behaviors that are aimed at promoting trust through disclosures that include openly sharing information and expressions of the true leader's thoughts and feelings. And the fourth quality, that authentic leader will have self-awareness, which refers to the extent to which leaders appear to understand their strengths, motives, and weaknesses, and how others also view their leadership. What that then creates within the group is something called positive psychological capital. And this is defined as a state of development characterized by, first, the group will have confidence to take on and put on the necessary effort to succeed. Secondly, they'll have optimism about succeeding now and in the future. Third, they'll be persevering towards goals, that is, they'll have hope. Fourthly, they'll have resilience, even in the face of difficulty. And so this social exchange theory, have I got that? Next slide. We haven't done that one, I think. Internalize. Sorry if I've made a mistake with the slides. Internalize, yeah, we've done that one. Yep. Oh, did we have the cartoons earlier? Yeah. So you might have seen in the cartoons that there's different types. Can we just go back to the cartoons quickly? My apologies to the technical team. So we've got different types of leadership experiences. Like sometimes we might feel like this in this cartoon, that it doesn't seem like a really good idea, but we've got to follow everyone off the cliff anyway. The second experience, so the next one, we might feel like we're just fitting in with the rest. So that type of leadership where we start off as in, don't worry, we'll make you into something. And so we all turn out the same at the other end. Then we might feel some leadership, well, we'll create a committee to decide what we're going to do. And then the committee, yes, that is what it says. But the committee actually decides that, no, we couldn't do it anyway. And so the committees are actually formed and become a negative thing rather than a positive enhancing thing. And then this one, that actually there's a leader who knows everything, but they don't want to share anything because they don't want anyone to copy them anyway. And so there's different types of, and then I ran through, I apologize, I was going to say that, and then I ran through all the bits I did. So sorry, thank you, technical team. So I'm right at the social exchange theory one. So social exchange theory suggests that people define themselves in terms of who they interact with. So when individuals are in a positive social exchange, they will openly share information and provide constructive feedback. Yeah, keep going. There we go. Provide feedback. Followers often go beyond their formal duties. Have we got that one? Followers often go beyond their formal duties. Nope. Okay, not to worry. Followers often go beyond their formal duties to help others because they feel that they're getting a reciprocation. And then, can we go to the slide on great souls? Because I'm just going to finish now. So my last three slides. And that was all the academic part. And because we're here, I wanted to connect it in to the main text that's studied in BK meditation, which is known as the Morally. And I was reading through, so the language is different. And today, since the morning, we heard the news of Muhammad Ali having passed away. And of course, his famous self-description was, "I am the greatest." And we've got many, Mahatma Gandhi, of course, the great soul. And I was hearing a description that George Foreman was giving on the radio. He's one of his competitors of Muhammad Ali. He was saying he was great because if you were a journalist who interviewed him, after you interviewed him, you became a better journalist. If you were a lawyer who met him, after you met him, you became a better lawyer. And I've heard similar descriptions of people who met Mahatma Gandhi as well. They felt better. And then this is a nice little passage of great souls within the Murali text, which is studied in this meditation center. "Those who are great souls have the aim of giving all souls the donation of happiness through their every interaction, that is, through their activity. They give happiness and receive happiness. Charity," so it's an interesting definition of charity here. "Charity is to give souls something through which blessings emerge from them. This is called an act of charity. Whomever you give happiness to, blessings will emerge from them for you." And I see that as authentic leadership in different language. And my final slide, my other interest, drama and English and literature. So I had to, 400 years since the death of Shakespeare, so I had to include some Shakespeare. And this comes from Hamlet. And Polonius is talking to his son, and he's bidding him farewell as he goes off on a voyage. And it's quite a nice speech, actually, with some good advice. And right at the end, he says, "This above all, to thine own self be true, and it must follow as the night the day. Thou canst not then be false to any man. Farewell. My blessing season, this in thee." Thank you.
Thank you, Shailen. Can I remind you after our first speaker that there is an opportunity to hear from you, your thoughts, your reflections, and your questions. So as you hear the speakers, please keep any questions you have in mind, and we'd love to hear those towards the end. We're now in for a treat. We have our next presenter is going to be speaking via Skype, and will come up on the screen in a moment. Her name is Dr. Carol Collins Ironlarger, and Carol is from Chicago. She is a long-standing educational leader in urban communities in the US. Carol has served as a teacher, assistant principal, district director, chief academic officer, and superintendent of schools. She is a results-oriented advocate for equitable public education that serves racially, culturally, and socially diverse families. Her research explores parents of colour and how they navigate schooling on behalf of their child within the context of institutional racism. Dr. Ironlarger coaches, monitors, and evaluates master's level students in educational leadership, and we'd love to hear from her. Please give her a warm welcome. Can I just say, Carol, there's about 70 or 80 or so people here. She sees us on the panel because that's who she's engaging with on our screen here. But you're speaking now to the audience. Over to you, Carol.
Okay, thank you so much. I hear a slight echo, so I'll do my best. First, I want to thank colleague Shailen for so many of the points that he's bringing forth in his research that are very relevant to the work of school leaders and the needs of educators to be able to connect effectively with communities. What I heard in his presentation that really spoke to the work that is necessary in our field is the importance of developing an atmosphere to create the relationships that lead to community cohesion. I heard him speak of the importance of trust as a key element to developing that cohesion. And I want to say that I respect what he has shared and acknowledge that it is very necessary to build in our schools and communities today. And unfortunately, we still see gaps in developing that. I know today we are discussing what particular steps are necessary to build community cohesion, trust, leading to development and inclusion. And what I'd like to emphasize here is that I see a gap. Research shows gaps in the ability for students and communities to be as served to the highest degree that they should be by many of our schools. And there are barriers to building this trust and community cohesion, which continue to persevere. And as long as they are persevering, then there's going to be an absence of full development and achievement for young people. Before I talk about the foundation for some of the research I have done and the research that I'm collaborating with Dr. Taysom, who is there today, I want to talk about the expectations for school leaders, the critical understandings that all leaders should have. The ELCC standards, which are the Educational Leadership Constituent Council standards, indicate that district level and school level educators are to apply the knowledge that promotes the success of every student by collaborating with faculty and community members, by responding to the diverse community interests, the needs, mobilizing community resources for the district, collecting and analyzing information pertinent to the improvement of the district's educational environment, promoting an understanding and appreciation and use of the community's diverse cultural, social, and intellectual resources throughout the district, throughout the building, in order to sustain positive relationships and to ensure that families and caregivers are cultivated and that the district uses this to partner with the community. And that continues to be a gap in our educational system. The state of affairs shows that there is an academic gap that is persistent for certain communities, most specifically communities of color, when compared to white middle class students. Now, I'm referring to some of the indicators used in the United States, like the National Assessment of Educational Process, the NAEP, which still shows a notable gap. For instance, approximately a 26-point difference at the fourth grade level and a 31-point difference at the eighth grade level in terms of the achievement in mathematics for Black and white students. In reading, approximately a 27-point difference at the fourth grade level and a 26-point difference at the eighth grade level. Now, of course, these particular measurements are always dynamic and always changing. But moreover, the real issue is there is a gap, and that gap is persistent. Now, what are the assertions? Well, the assertions created by some of the research I've done and that which is being expanded upon by Dr. Taysom is that society is plagued with racialization, that although we purport a post-racial condition, racial barriers still exist in our society. And because our institutions have been built on a cultural consciousness that reflects middle-class white European and European-American values, this creates a situation where other communities of color or those that fall out of that boundary, even low-income white children, the capital that they possess, their understandings, their value system, their ways of knowing and doing, are not necessarily encapsulated by our schools. And this creates a situation that promotes an inequality in their educational outcome, an inequality in their educational experience. And with the work Dr. Taysom and I are doing, an inequality in the ability for their parents to connect with the educational system. And we're arguing that it's this connection with the educational system which promotes a successful experience for children. We look at Bourdieu and the work of his legacy that indicates the importance of people being able to acquire a certain set of skills, which gives them access to the standards and understandings that are prevailing in a society. But we also note that with students of color, and the work that I initiated with my research and that we're building upon focuses on students who are Black experiencing education in primarily white middle-class environments in the United States. Those particular students and their family are marginalized. Marginalized because the set of skills and attributes that they possess, their own community capital, which researcher Sol Lorenzano speaks of, that notion of community capital that you see with critical race theory, that particular capital is not recognized by our institutions because of the legacy of institutional racism. And therefore, these marginalized groups experience a disconnect from the educational system. What we purport is that it's critical for our educational systems to be inclusive. And for parties on both sides, both those in the institution and those in the community, and then also those in families, to be able to cross bridges, so to speak, bridges of understanding, in order to connect their climates, understand their capital, and be able to fuse those so that we can build these communities of trust. The original research that I conducted in this community, which was based on 26 parents in qualitative exploratory research through intensive interviews that spoke to their understandings of the experiences of their 24 students as they navigated and attempted to navigate the primarily white middle-class school. And I want to emphasize, team and guests, that this school and this community is one that values education. The parents sought this community for the purposes of being able to provide their child the best education. And the community is well-funded with education. But nonetheless, what was found was that parents did see themselves as experiencing racism and their children as experiencing racism. And moreover, the school did not exercise all steps, in the opinion of the parents, to truly connect them and to embody them. And the idea of social capital, which would allow them to build the networks that would give them the information to be able to navigate school and advocate on behalf of their children, that capital was very weak. And although the parents talked about school, in general sense, they didn't get the type of information that would really allow them to be partners in progress in the academic processes for their children. They were very marginalized from this situation. And we also speak in the research to the importance not only of acknowledging cultural capital and how that's either activated or deactivated due to the vestiges of exclusion that these organizations have created because of longstanding racism. We also speak to the notion of social capital and how that capital works or for or against communities, who they know, what they know. Is it robust or is it weak? And we argue that without a very concerted approach to ensure that multiple cultures, their ways of knowing and doing, are encapsulated and respected by larger communities and the larger society, then even social capital becomes very weak and ineffective for families. So in the context of what we're discussing today, I applaud the effort to really bring to the stage the particular issues that need to be attacked in order for us to be able to bring about more of this, what we would call cultural straddling or bridging of these networks, so that communities who may be on the outside of what we often call the mainstream can be encapsulated and respected. And the so-called mainstream institutions then become more democratic in their approach and become more inclusive, thereby ensuring that both sides of the coin, the families and communities who seek high-level success in traditional organizations and the institutional gatekeepers who are within the organization, are able to be mutually supportive to one another.
involved in education. There might be something there that resonates with you as you've engaged with some of those challenges that face students, or even as parents of children that have gone through some of those instances. I hope that's been helpful for the way Carol's been processing these needs for education. Next we have Sergeant Rich, who has come from the local neighbourhood. Sergeant Rich Lane is the neighbourhood sergeant for the Belgrave and Rushley Mead wards, and is active in the community immediately around Harmony House here. So we'd like to hear from him.
Thank you very much. I've been asked to come here to talk about the police and trust, and the trust in the police, if there is some. I'd like to think there is. I've always been told it's easy, isn't it, not to trust somebody. You always have a barrier there. It's always set up straight away. You might have had a bad experience with the police. You might have had, you might have reported a crime where a perpetrator has not necessarily been caught, and that's left a bad or sour taste in your mouths about the police. You might have been brought up hating the police due to personal circumstances, whether that be your family, and they've been separated due to violence, and the police have been there, and you see it as the police have been involved in separating those couple. It may be that you come from a community or a country where that the police are corrupt, and that they use violence, and it might be that you've moved across here and you still see the police in that way. It might be something that you've seen on the press. It might be something that you believe from the media. It's very easy not to trust the police. But I think the majority of people probably wouldn't have had any experience with the police, whether you've had the unfortunateness of reporting a crime and having an actual police officer come out to you. I think that is very rare. And so how do we trust the police? Because doesn't trust have to be earned? How does the police earn your trust if the majority of people never actually speak to an officer? And that's where my job comes in, because I'm one of the neighbourhood police officers and sergeant down on the Belgrave. It's my job to get out and speak to the community and have my team go out and speak to you guys. So it's got me thinking when I was asked to come here to give this little speech about how is it that we do build trust on our team? How is it that we change the view of people that don't trust us? And how do we build the relationship within the community themselves between them? I think we do a lot of work that quite a lot of people probably don't know the police do. In relation to if you call 999 or 101, we will come out and deal with your crimes. And you probably all know about that. You'll see a police car dashing about with blue lights going on. But do you know what we do apart from that? Did you know that we deal with all the issues that matter most to you? The ASB, the loud music, the litter, street drinking, parking issues. All of that gets reported to your police service, yet we have no powers in relation to that, but we'll still attend. We'll still try and sort those issues out. We'll speak to you about those issues, and we'll try and get that connection, that personal touch, to sort of speak to neighbours and try and come to a sort of community agreement. If you've got loud music going on, we're trying to mediate between people and bring those communities back together again rather than hating each other. We patrol on foot and bike. You might not see us, but we do. And we are out there. And we do speak to people. We do regular patrols of schools. We walk through the schools during the day. You might not have heard of that, but we do. We're there. We go and speak to classes. We go and speak to children. We give talks on important subjects. Drugs, knife crime, stranger danger, the internet safety and bullying. And we're there educating the children from first hand. We also set up a scheme called School Detectives. This is whereby we go into the schools for a day and we set out a little crime and they become the detectives. They work together as a school, as a team, and that builds bonding with us and the school children themselves and the kids. We actively take part in religious ceremonies and events like Diwali, the Holi Festival, where we see people throwing colour over us. And if you're not seeing it in the paper or on our websites, then I was caped in colour and the kids loved it. And we get involved with that because that's building our community, relationship. If they can see us as a person rather than just a uniform, the first thing that you see in this stage, probably the reflective vest in front of you. But do you see me as a person? Do you see me going out and speaking to your children? Do you see me as a person that can happily play with your kids, as in throwing colour over them, and then hopefully if they had a problem, they can come and speak to me because they feel they're comfortable? We've started numerous different projects that you might not have heard of. Leicestershire Kicks is one of them, whereby children that are slipping into ASB or crime and are on the cusps of losing them down the wrong path, we set up a programme with Leicester Football Club whereby they will get free training sessions if they'll sit through our life crime, our inputs, our child safety awareness. We'll give them those inputs, they'll get free training sessions with Leicester Football Club. That way, they've got this incentive to behave. If they don't behave, they don't get to go. And they've got this will that they want to go and do this. It's been so successful that we're now starting it up with Leicester Riders, the basketball, and the Leicester Cricket Club. Many things that you don't think police officers do, but we'll go out and assist with those projects. We also look at the other end of the scale. We saw you speak about the elderly. Now the elderly, we set up Tea and Toast. So we'll organise a Tea and Toast every Tuesday at Weymouth Church. And we'll go down and we encourage the elderly to come down and they start building that sort of community between them and encourage them to report crimes, because that's the worst part, trying to get people to report things to us so we can help them, especially with the elderly thinking it's too much trouble for us. We've got schools, numerous schools that are hard to reach, hard to get into, don't trust the police because of where they come from in their past. And we set up football games. We'll go out and play football with them. And we'll do a lot of work to get that and earn that trust that you might not see. It's not reported in the press. Recently, obviously in this area, we have numerous different cultures. Somalians have come into the Belgrave area. Very hard to reach for the police because they don't trust us. And so we've set up sports events where we'll close a whole road off and we'll start playing football, we'll start playing different activities with the children, with the council. We'll be there so they can see us, they'll come and play with us, and that builds the trust to start with. We also have a number of different things that we do. You'll always hear about police officers stopping and searching people, and that no one trusts the police. Are they doing it legally? Are they not? Well, now we're starting to dish out the information firsthand. So if you get stopped and searched, you get a leaflet explaining all your rights. We're open and honest about everything, what we can do and what we can't do. We also now wear these body cameras. So we film our interactions with members of the public, which people might not like. But we've got nothing to hide about what we say to you. We've got nothing to hide about how we deal with incidents. We've got nothing to hide about why we're searching somebody. So we're happy to share that information. This has led to a reduction in the time it takes to investigate police complaints, because people complain about us doing our jobs. But when we've got our actions filmed and recorded, it soon reduces that time because we can quickly see whether we've done something wrong. And we're open and honest about that. That's hopefully building the trust with the public as well. I think the policing has come on a long way since, obviously, we've begun. And over the last few years in particular, getting out into communities and really, really trying to build that trust, we see it as a very, very important role. And we put, I think it's 21% of our sort of policing personnel into neighbourhood policing, offering this service, which is extremely important. I think it'll be a bad day that we ever get rid of neighbourhood policing. Thank you.
I can attest that when Rich arrived, the microphone on his walkie-talkie was going with his team dealing with issues in your community right here. So the active nature of that work that is happening this very moment is on his shoulder, and he's stepped away from that in order to share with us today, so we really do appreciate that. Our next speaker is Alison beside me, who I introduced earlier, who's one of the organisers of today's panel. So please welcome Alison.
Thank you. Suggested earlier, I work at the School of Education and I'm privileged enough to be in the top 2% of universities in the world at the University of Leicester. And the programmes that we offer, they really change people's lives, they make a difference. And I think as a public service, with the four core principles of searching for truth, which is about trust, being respectful, which is about inclusion, being critical, which is about not just taking one side, but having alternative perspectives and trying to balance the different arguments to find a way forward together. And then the creation of new knowledge. It's those crucial parts of public service that come together. And why I'm so grateful to Shailen and to Bupen for putting this together is the way that we can bridge the academy and theory with practice and the taxpayer who's paying for the research. And so you really need to hold us accountable to how is this making a difference to my life, like the police do. And I'm so very grateful for Sergeant Richard Lane coming today, because when we call them for help and they come, they very often don't know what they're going to face, what they're walking into, and they're keeping us safe so that we don't have to deal with very, very horrific things. And so he's talked about trust and inclusion, but there is another side that he hasn't spoken in depth about that I think has kept community cohesion together. So really grateful for that, and all frontline services, emergency services. So thinking about what my colleague, Dr. Carol Collins-Iron-Larger said about building capital in our education systems for inclusion and respect is what my research is about with Carol and with 18 nation states from all continents in the world that is informing a Horizon 2020 bid, which Tim Fawcett is part of with his project, The Feast, which he'll talk to you about. And what we want to do is explore cases in these different nation states where we can build capacity for all capitals to come together through discourse, through the actual critical thinking and talking together to find out how different capitals are respected and celebrated. And this is something that Carter 2008 calls, let's use identity schemas. And that's simply, let's find out about what we value about our cultural heritage. Let's find out about the heroes. One of my heroes, I'm wearing a trumpet that my parents bought for me from the Jewelry Quarter in Birmingham. And it's my hero, Louis Armstrong, who was a trumpet player I listened to a lot when with jazz. And I now have a painting of St. Louis Cathedral from New Orleans on my wall, because I was fortunate enough to go to an American Educational Research Association conference there. And I think as we start to find out about heroes and we start to find out why these people are important, then we can learn more about each other's cultures. For example, Dr. Martin Luther King, if we learn more about the civil rights movement and we learn more about courageous people that make a difference, like Lord Gandhi, these people are so important, but do all major or dominant cultures know about these people and know about the cultures that can enrich our understanding of what it is to be human? And so by celebrating these cultural diversities through what Carol called cultural straddling, we need to think not just about the politic, about you connecting with your local member of the European Parliament or your local councillor or your local member of parliament for the UK and lobbying and saying, we would like this changed, or we don't understand how privatising the land registry, how that's in the manifesto. Can you explain that, please? All this about being transparent. When you look at the politics, it goes beyond that. It's also about the economic. So what our research is seeking to do is how can we build and create entrepreneurialism, creative, innovative young people who can work with intergenerational communities, that's people of all ages, to build small and medium enterprises. this social entrepreneurship could potentially challenge some of the public corporations that may not have an understanding of local communities and their needs. And so, for example, I'm very privileged that John McCallum came today, and he has got access to a fund where you can apply for money from £250. I think there's a ceiling on that of maybe £5,000. And you can ask for some money to build a public community cohesion project. Now, I checked with the local council, and it is possible to hire an allotment and possible to grow food for your own consumption, but also perhaps to supply local restaurants. And they would perhaps be glad to have local community homegrown organic products. So what starts as a hobby and bringing people together to have fun and enjoy the outside could actually become something more. Maybe people could start their own restaurant. Maybe this is a way of developing our community. I know the First Lady, Michelle Obama, talks a lot about the White House gardens. And I know John Dewey talks about how important it is to understand the natural world and to understand how we grow food and for sustainability. So perhaps through our research, we can begin to connect with parents, with children, young people and staff to think about how together can we build the kind of capital that Dr. Carol Collins Iron Larger talked about, that is shared, that takes perhaps a multicultural approach where we have tolerance for difference, but perhaps even celebration for difference, where we meet together on core principles of alignment, such as inclusion, respect, and trust. And from that point, we can build political capital together. We can build cultural capital through straddling different cultures and understanding each other, and then economic capital, so that together we can start to grow small and medium enterprises so that we can fund ourselves and not be perhaps so reliant on multicultural companies that supply the needs of the shareholder rather than the needs of the local community. And a key way of doing this is through the schools, where we work with teachers and we find out where they're at as a baseline in this kind of participation between home and school, and how we understand the way the young people connect what they're learning with what they want to be in the future, the kind of life they have where they have their own home, where they can have a family, where they can have hopes, and where they can provide for their own pension and contribute to that for their own well-being as a lifelong learner. So when we look at that, are they able to make sense of the curriculum, and what do they need to get the kind of cultural relevancy to the curriculum to make the learning meaningful so that they can reach their own goals and their own attainment and their own future aspirations? So we work with the teachers and the young people and the parents and stakeholders from local companies, from the police, from social workers, from health, from all areas within the community. And we try and build understanding of what and how we can help and facilitate these young people to be social entrepreneurs. And then the teachers, the children, the young people and the parents, they conduct their own research. They ask important questions. They seek evidence to answer those questions. And they make judgments about the warrants for the claims that are made. Can I trust this evidence? Where's it come from? Who's undertaken it? Whose interests does it serve? Is it balanced? Is it critical? And this is where the Philosophy of Society of Great Britain, that I joined through Dr. Rini Saran, SFCP, has been so important for me, because it enables me to have the thinking tools to not just accept what people say to me, but I can say, well, how can I challenge that? Where is information for me to find out if there's another view? And when we can be critical like that, we can start to answer and address the problems of society together. And rather than perpetuate the inequalities and the patterns that we might see perpetuated through education systems, we can work together for equity and renewal. And that's the theory that we bring to from the academy to bridge with the practicum, with the schools. And then with the schools, they tell us what's happening at the moment. Together, we develop some intervention strategies, and we now have schemes of work that map to 10 standards, that map back to 10 principles from the case studies we've done with the pilot. And those schemes of work are then implemented over a year, and then we try and understand a year later the impact or how we've made a difference to the participation and the connection politically, culturally, and economically of those young people in an intergenerational community to make a difference to their educational outcomes, their college eligibility, can they now go to university, and their entrance to the labour market, and a meritocratic approach to what you might call middle-class benefits, rather than middle-class benefits coming to those from a privileged community with a dominant capital for that particular curriculum. So when we've worked out how the impact can be understood, we then disseminate that through books, through articles, but also with the general public through events like this. So we'd be so grateful to have your feedback to find out if this is the kind of thing that you want taxpayers' money spent on, to try and engage the public in and through the schools as a hub, to equip young people to be social entrepreneurs for equity and renewal. And if there are some things you haven't understood that we could perhaps make clearer, or that we could perhaps amend, change, we're just open to delivering the best we can with our research to improve practice and to make a difference for the better. And thank you for your time.
Alison, I might just make a note that John McCallum represents the Near Neighbours program. Some of you here in Leicester may be aware of Near Neighbours, and he's available to talk about the small grants program they offer and the wider services of Near Neighbours. Thank you for our formal presentations, all four of you, thank you. As we're being hosted in a meditation centre here at Harmony House, it seems appropriate that we take this opportunity to reflect for a few minutes on all the things that we have heard. So I'd like to invite Sister Indu, who is a coordinator here at Harmony House, to come and lead us for a five-minute reflection.
Om Shanti. Up until now, we've heard all the speakers saying one word again and again, and that is trust. Other words have also come up. And firstly, we need to realize that before I can start to trust others, I need to learn to trust myself. And trust is very much connected to self-respect also. And if we think about it, what is it that takes away our self-esteem, takes away our self-respect? And certain things that come to mind are what we see within the community also, but within ourselves, is that addictions, dependencies, these kind of things, not just to drugs or drinking, etc., but any form of addiction where I'm dependent, I'm a slave to something, will take away my self-respect and I won't be able to trust myself. It's not just physical addictions that I'm referring to. There are other internal addictions also. And they also take away our self-respect, anger, greed, attachments, ego. When I'm addicted to these things, then how can I trust other people? And so what I'd like to do now is just a meditation for a few minutes where, and the very simple formula for meditation, for those who are new to meditation, is 3 steps. And I think it will help with community cohesion. First step is going inwards. Second step, to go upwards, to take what I need from upwards. And then the third step, which is relevant to today's talk, is the outwards. When I'm going out into the community, or when I'm wanting to bring the community together. That's what community cohesion is about, no? To bring it together, to unify, to cross barriers of culture, religion, race, caste, age groups, all of that. And so just a few minutes exercise we're going to do. Very simple, you can relax. No posture or no mantras are needed. I'm going to speak a few thoughts and just follow those thoughts. Obviously, when you're trying to follow the guided thoughts, other thoughts will interfere. There'll be distractions. Put them to one side. So we'll go inwards and upwards. Om Shanti. I, the being, the energy, the light that controls this body, the master of this body, the master of my 5 senses, and the master of my intellectual faculties also. The faculty of the mind, the faculty of my personality. I, the light, the being, with my thoughts, I connect with a higher being. I go upwards beyond the physical, beyond this world of action, activity, pollution. Beyond this world, there is the spiritual world, the world from where we have all come. I, the soul, am a resident of this world of light. And in this world of light, I connect with the supreme light, with the divine. I am face to face or in front of this beautiful light, the one who is my provider and my protector, the one whom we say, our Father, our guide, our teacher. In front of this one, I, the soul, am filling myself with the qualities necessary in this world. I am filling myself with peace, with love, with happiness, with forgiveness. I am taking from the divine. He does not mind. He's willing to give me everything. He has it in abundance. The wholesaler, the one who says, you are mine, and to whom we say, I belong to the divine. I absorb the vibrations, the atmosphere of this place. This is my real home. And now, with my thoughts, I come back to this world which we call the stage. All the world's a stage, and I am acting my role on this world stage. Om Shanti. Wasn't difficult, was it? And if we do this again and again, whenever we have a few minutes, what I'm doing simply is recharging the battery of the soul. Because whilst we're busy or engrossed or involved in all of these attempts, all of these efforts for bringing the community together, I'm losing energy. So where do I regain that energy from? I need to top up every now and then. Because what's happening is souls who can't connect with the divine, they'll take from me. They'll take from all of us. And so I also need to recharge. And that's what meditation simply means. It means to heal. Healing only happens when there's hurt, and it also means to recharge. There's no hurt, but I need to top up. Om Shanti.
Thank you, Sister Hindu. It's now about to be your opportunity to engage with this material and to reflect on what we've heard, but also to ask your questions. But it might help for me just to give a brief introduction to why I'm in the role I'm in and my background. I lead a charity called The Feast, which is currently based in Birmingham but works in Luton, Tower Hamlets and Bradford. We also do some work in Lebanon and we've done some other work in Europe. The work that we do was started by a Christian youth worker who was dissatisfied with the way young people of faith in particular engaged with each other. They were either put into a room together or put onto a football pitch together and asked to do the same thing at the same time, and it was presumed that that would make them friends. Or they were sat in a classroom or a lecture theatre and told how they needed to relate to each other. But there weren't opportunities for them to find ways to disagree peacefully at each other. So this Christian youth worker created a set of rules that defined conversations between young people. We call them our guidelines for dialogue. They are the secret source of our work. And they teach young people, and our focus is young people, to do things like speaking positively about their own faith and not negatively about someone else's. The natural go-to for us is that we know we're right, and our sense of understanding of the world is based on our understanding of our beliefs and our worldview. So we presume that everyone else is wrong and we need to address that wrong. But we're teaching teenagers to share the best of their faith and their worldview, and through sharing that, to give the other person an opportunity to share theirs. We also teach young people not to treat people that they meet as a spokesperson for their faith or their community. Now, you can probably tell I'm not a natural Brummie. I am from Australia originally, and so I might be the first Australian many of you have met, but I do not represent 22 or 23 million Australians. I am one. In the same way that if you meet me as a Christian, you do not meet all of Christendom, you meet me. And yet our media, our societies, our faith groups and our cultural groups tend to stamp people with a label. And when one person of that faith does something, we take that baggage to all of those people. So the work that I'm a part of, which Dr. Allison here has been very encouraging of and is looking to use, is the way we work with teenagers. And I feel very privileged to sit with some people that are practitioners and thinkers in this field of work. If I could, before inviting you to share, some initial reflections that I had were, particularly through Rich and Carol, was the problems that we have in our world with cohesion. That we do have society that does have racial, faith-based, societal conflict. It's the norm. And unfortunately, it's not going away. And the reality is that trust is low for the people that go in to help these communities. And I don't know about you, but I was heartbroken to hear Carol's statistics around the difference between black and white students. And I thank her for sharing some of those figures. I'm sure even though they're American-based, they probably reflect the educational attainment for many minority communities here. And yet, there are solutions being generated, solutions through authentic leadership and the way leaders and influencers of places like schools are being generated, and then through social enterprises. I hadn't thought of a community garden as a way of building a more cohesive and positive society, but a simple enterprise like that could become a real model for the future. So there's going to be a microphone handed around. If I can have some instructions. If the microphone comes to you, can you please stand and can you say where you're from or your name? If you are from a group or if you're, it's like a brief introduction, very brief introduction for yourself. And can I also encourage you to give any question or reflection that you've got. Please do not feel that if you're not an expert or a leader, no question will not be welcomed by the panel. So please ask any question you have, even if it is basic as what is community cohesion, because that might be a question you've got today. But our first question. Just a second. There we go.
My name is Leslie from the Beltane Spring Fair Group. We're a group of pagan people of other faith and no faith that do celebrations of festivals. We're also being given for the first time in one of the community gardens at Clarendon Park space to have a solstice ceremony this year, which is very nice. A couple of things struck me. First of all, about the schools. I don't know if you know this, but 26 out of every 30 new social enterprises end in the first 3 months of the year. So it's, you know, it's an uphill struggle at the best of times. The other one is my daughter, who's a teacher, runs MP6 meetings every year. The finals are in June. And they're a platform for young children to speak about anything that concerns them, mostly political, but anything at all that concerns them for 3 minutes by video, which is recorded in public, and that goes for 6 schools in Leicester that send representatives that go through the competition till the finals. And it's quite invigorating, the variety of things, everything from refugees to shorter school hours. And it's quite an inspiring sort of thing to do. That's held at the Civil Hall sometime in June. I'm sure people would love to go to it. The other thing is that I was a bit concerned from the outset by the words of leaders and followers. The pagan community don't have many leaders. They have a few rich pagans that go everywhere a lot, and they have quite a few poor pagans that can't get to anywhere. And good examples, I think, might have been better for my understanding, because it's our sort of understanding that you are responsible for yourself and serve in that capacity by giving out what you can. So that was a difficulty for me. But the whole idea of using schools and asset building and sort of the new thing that's coming out from the Tories now of registering every community asset frightens me to death. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Could you remind me of your name again, please?
Leslie.
Thanks, Leslie. Yes, I left the words that those researchers, you would have seen references in the slides, and they use leaders and followers. So I left those in there. My understanding of why those words are in there are that in a structure, so rather than a faith-based concept, but to say a certain organizations, they were distinguishing between leaders, and then in a structure, you've got people who are following that leader. And so I think it's more in that context rather than a religious context where you've got a leader and follower and it becomes like a guru system. I don't think that was the context that that was meant within. I think in terms of the word leader, in fact, it was the word leadership that's crucial. So it's authentic leadership. And so Sister Indu, I think, brought us back to that point, which was it begins with the self. So I would say, I think the point of the talk was that it's actually the authentic leader, the one who has looked at themselves and starts from that inner point of view and is looking at self-leadership in a very proactive way that then can build trust within the community, which the phrases in the literature were like building psychological, the capital of psychological trust. And so then it was that following on. So the follower is more in the case of the chain that's happening between authentic leadership, psychological trust within the group, and then community cohesion.
Thank you. Our next question was over here somewhere. Yeah. Do you want to stand up and say your name? And
hello. Yeah, my name's Avril Taylor. I studied youth and community development at De Montfort, and I now work within the homeless community, mainly around teenagers. I think looking around today, I think it's a shame that we couldn't reach out to a few more young people, you know, and listen to maybe some of their experience, strength and hope as well. I believe a lot of, for me, a lot of the gaps in what we're seeing in education. I mean, for me, I was dyslexic and I was also in addiction. So I'm sort of, I live in recovery. I was from a sort of white middle class background, had a Hindu wedding. My little boy's half Indian, has a disability. And I think I've been very fortunate in the area that I've studied to basically be able to understand, you know, people's their time and their space and their culture and their religious differences as to sort of their attitudes, basically. And it's only when I look at now I've removed my son from his mainstream school. He's actually in a special needs school. And he isn't the only mixed race child in the school either. So he's obviously a lot more comfortable with that. He's come on a long way. But, you know, the point that it wasn't really, well, it maybe is a question really around, you know, what the children are being taught and how the children are being taught. Is that totally relevant today? You know, I did a lot of research around the gap in provisions for teenage black boys, basically in education, and that it was basically, there was a massive gap and there was a massive failing in that area. And I look at the sort of the history that's being taught in our schools today, is that totally relevant? Especially like in Leicester, we are a massive multicultural a society, which I'm really proud of, you know, and it's nice to be able to come here today. Hello. Yeah, I'd just like to say thank you for giving me the opportunity of everybody else's perspectives, you know, on what they believe. But I still really think it's important for me. I believe that our children are tomorrow and they need to have, we need to start to, you know, it's been spoke about trust. And we need to start trusting in young people for young people to start trusting in us. Mm. I don't think it's a religious or it should be a class, a religion or a system. I think it should be come down to giving love, trust and letting young people have a voice. So, yeah, I'll shut up now. But thank you very much.
Thank you. Any panellists would like to respond?
I think you make some really important points. And I think the comparative education that we're doing addresses these issues. For example, my colleague, Professor Hawa Imam in Nigeria, she's doing research and working in an area where Boko Haram are operating. So it's a very challenging situation for her. And I think that working with the young people and working with the leadership of the school as designated by job description, those role incumbents are finding it very challenging to be participatory and to listen to young people's voices because it challenges the traditions. And so what Howard has done is presented research, and they have begun to have the trust in themselves and their systems to develop more participatory ways of thinking and doing. And these are opportunities then for young people to think critically and to look at alternative ways and to look at culturally relevant arguments in the curriculum so that they relate to their own lives. And I think when we have standards in schools and there are focuses on accountability for students' attainment in the UK with Ofsted, quite rightly, we need to be accountable, but teachers also need, I think, to have the time and the space to slow down, let children think about the feedback they've just been given on their assessment, and to reflect on it and address it. And I think there is such pressure to get through a very busy and full curriculum that having the time to develop pedagogical relationships where pedagogy is developed as the science and art of learning and teaching, it can be very challenging to have that kind of time. In primary schools, I think they have more time, but in secondary schools, when you have so many hours with the children and young people a week, I think that can be an issue. So looking at the comparative education, I think it's very much about what are the traditions of the curriculum, if we're introducing participation. Similarly, a paper I'm doing with my colleague, Professor Khalid Arar in Palestine. Again, we've got similar, how do we engage with traditions and look at organisational effectiveness and how we change to improve situations, but also how do we give teachers the time to do that and how do we prepare them to do that? I know at Leicester we have outstanding education, as Ofsted have identified, and all our teachers come out as newly qualified teachers and get jobs, and we're really very proud of what we've achieved. And I think the next step therefore is to develop them, not just to meet all the standards, but I think for them to engage with the philosophies of learning and teaching and the sociological aspects of relationship building. And I don't know if we move teaching, education and instruction into the schools, whether the teachers have time to do that, to look at research in that depth. So I do think we need the universities to support teacher training, teacher education, to provide these opportunities.
We have a question over here.
My name's Daphne. I come from Loughborough, and I've spent quite a lot of time in community work, particularly in the last bit working for Racial Equality Council. But there are two things that concern me. One is I retired some time ago, so some of the words that are used are quite difficult for me. And one of those is that the use of the phrases social capital, economic capital, cultural capital, because I'm still not sure in myself what they mean. Even though I've kept up with the reading, these words come up a time and again. But the other question I'd like to put is, how do we get through the concept, if you like, that everybody has to be in competition in order to get the top jobs, to get into university, and it's instilled into them with marks at the end of each term and all this kind of thing, when actually what we want is for them to be cooperating together in so that when they come into society, they're no longer competing. Thank you.
I'm here. Would you speak again, Tim, and summarize what the woman has said so I can hear it clearly?
The question was associated with the more modern terms of capital. So it was social capital, cultural capital, economic capital. So that was the first question. Can you answer that for someone who's retired and no longer in youth work or addressing racial equality, those are terms that are new to her. So what do you mean by capital?
Okay. All right, thank you so much, Tim. Well, capital is the ways of knowing and doing, the attributes, the understandings, the access channels to the particular source. For instance, when you speak of cultural capital within, let's just say, a family, you have the types of rituals, the understandings, the way in which they approach the system, their experiences within a system, all of that is embodied within one's capital, all right? And then the ability or the inability to utilize those understandings in order to engage in successful practices. So when we're speaking of marginalized communities, the way in which a child grows up, his or her experiences, one of the clear indicators when we think of the experiences of some groups of people would be, how did their parents experience the educational system? What are their recollections of what occurred during their schooling years? And how is that now transferred to the child? So the parent serves as a strong source of capital to the family and to the child. And then moreover, the child works to navigate through the system. Dr. Case and I are speaking of making sure that we acknowledge that the way in which the systems have been constructed, like for the research that we're speaking of, the foundational research is looking at American systems, but construction of those systems are done through ideologies that operate outside of families of color, low-income families, those that are marginalized. The construction of the system is done in the vein of those who controlled the system, and that did not reflect and still does not reflect those communities I'm speaking of. So am I understanding that our colleague is asking, because she is retired, how does she then participate in the generation of capital or the support of students acquiring capital? Is that what I'm hearing, Tim?
You've done well. You have clarified that. Could I ask a supplementary question to that? And this is sort of tied into a few of the presenters. A reflection that I've got is that minority communities care more about cohesion or about injustice or about oppression than majorities. So if you live in an affluent white community, your sense of what racism is totally different to someone who is of a different colour, who walks down the high street here in Leicester and might get racism on a daily basis. If your own children have less access to an educational path than someone from a community that has lots of access, is there, and I guess this is even to Richard, do you think there is a different understanding of need to grapple with this topic from different people in societies?
Yes, Tim and team and guests, yes, there is a different understanding. I think it's critical that we acknowledge that everyone has their own cultural context, their way of knowing and seeing and navigating the world. When we speak of notions like white privilege, we must acknowledge that many whites don't necessarily recognize the privilege that they have because it's a lived experience for them. So people navigate in the way that they know how. But that does not exonerate them or any community from making sure that they take whatever opportunity they can to then understand the plight of others, which is why when we look at the numbers of teachers in the United States, approximately 70% or more are middle-class white females. So they are going into all different types of schooling environments. they may not have understood or understand the cultural context of the students that they are going to face. And we can't blame them for that, but we can expect of them the steps to be taken to gain an understanding of the cultural context, which is why I'm very pleased to be able to support as an associate tutor the work of Leicester University, University of Leicester, because what I see in the educational leadership preparation direction is a very, very concerted effort to ensure that the graduate students are able to understand race, culture, social dynamics, and all these different particular characteristics that define not only the diversity of a city like Leicester, but much broader, the diversity of the world. So it's not a finger-pointing situation. I don't go around and say, as an African American, how come you don't understand my story? You better understand my story. That would be selfish for me to say that. But what I can say to others is, let's share stories so that we can collectively do the good work. And that should be expected by all of us. And when we come to the table, we should come being able to bear our fallibilities, being able to say, I really don't know. Please tell me. And not expected to be able to say, I understand, because you can understand someone else's experience, but you can say, I empathize, I respect, I want to learn more. And it requires us taking risks. I tell the graduate students that I work with also here in the States, teaching for Eastern Illinois University, primarily white students, I tell them that you have to be real ready to take risks. I have taken risks. As a teacher in a primarily Latino community, I have made mistakes. I have made assumptions. I have had my Latino families correct me. And it's been a very empowering piece, which has made me a much more effective and conscientious educator. So, Tim, we have to be willing to say what we know without making assumptions and ask for what we don't know. And I believe strongly that we will continue to grow and create this cross-cultural understanding, inclusion, and development that Allison is speaking of as we move forward. I do respect what she speaks of in terms of identity schemers. We have to also ensure that we understand ourselves. And I think that it's very important that we not take a unilateral approach vis-a-vis, I can't say as an African-American educator that I know the sensibilities and desires of every African-American child and his or her family. I have to recognize that everyone looks through their own lens, but I can facilitate an environment where I try to develop that type of understanding and trust. And that's what I hear you doing there today.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's harder for us with the smaller minorities to get in and speak with them and build that trust, because there's fewer people that will come forward to speak to us, community leaders that we class them as. So with our Asian communities, those that have temples, it's easy for us to go into those places and meet people that are willing to spread or help spread our word and our advice. But with the sort of the smaller communities, the Hmong community that's just up and coming in Leicester, that's incredibly hard for us because we don't have those connections yet. I think that's quite interesting to have pointed out, that the smaller communities are harder to reach than the larger ones. Interesting.
You, Rich and Carol, the vulnerability to say that I'm a learner as well. Even a minority can say I'm a learner as I learn from other people I engage with. So thank you, Carol, for the way you said that you've had to learn from the Hispanic community in the US, who are another minority, so that we're never at the top of that tree. We never have all the knowledge and we're always correct. We're always in this state of having to learn in whatever, whether we're in a service provider, in academic or education, or even in society or faith leaders. We're constantly needing to have that open heart and mind to be vulnerable and learn. There's probably enough time for one more question. We have three more questions. Whoa. Okay, we'll see if we can squeeze them in. We'll have to be fairly quick.
My name is Priya. I am a mental health nurse practitioner. I've worked for about 20 years in UK as a mental health nurse. I have to say that I've had a lot of questions about well-being. Coercion is also the well-being at all level, from pre-born children to from womb to tomb, as they say. And as I heard all your good speech and all that has been discussed, I feel that the most important thing I've realized myself, I did not have answers to my question. I came here by chance, and all I have to say is that I've heard people doing a lot of work with the children. I've seen from children to older adults. I have to be so grateful to Indu Ben, who's made me realize what mental health and well-being is all about. I'm just thinking, when I went through education, I thought there are children who could be seen as they enter the system. They are classified as liabilities or assets to the system. We're all focusing on the competition, on the capitals. And what we forget is our true self. When we're talking about racism or any difference, it's all on the outside. What I got here is that when we are comfortable in the inside and we meet someone who is exactly as comfortable within themselves, you feel you're in a very comfortable company. And when you enter a school, even though there are problems where we don't know where the family background comes from, you don't judge the situation from the outside. But you, if you have discovered yourself inside, you will help not identify problem only and judge that person and classify that person as an asset. I feel that that person start to appreciate themselves from childhood. If a child don't feel appreciated, they won't fit in. Forget about what color we are, because all of us, the same color of blood runs through our vein. So one South African colleague told me that. She said to me, forget about what color you are. The minute you are comfortable with yourself, everyone will be comfortable with you and be loved and supported and respected. And I feel a lot of time in healthcare, we do identify problem, but we can make someone a problem and diagnose it. It's an affirmation that there is something significantly wrong. But how do we help that person? It's the way the community is going and education is going, the healing is through proper education, and that's what I found here. And I really embrace that education, which is of the self, going within. And then it's really healing everyone, not through medication, but the most subtle, powerful medication relies on us. This is what I've got here, and I have to be ever so grateful. And I really hope this community can phase into healthcare and education, where I don't say that I'm here as a Brahma Kumari member. All I say is that there's a lot of positivity to find real gem of knowledge and solution to problems. And what my question is, when we are dealing with children coming to secondary, I just feel like it's a seed that is blossoming. When the children are not picked up on primary leadership, good leadership, it saddened me to see that when the problem is taken into secondary, then the tree has already become firm. It becomes a bit challenging, but there's always hope. I know there's always hope. But when leadership in school takes real care in embracing healthcare service with education, not to compete, but to see how that the children are growing in their character, their well-being, then we won't have many more mental hospital. Or I know the police does a good job, but it's all about allowing the parents who are suffering with mental health problem or other financial problem to trust the police, to trust someone. And who do they trust? That's my question. Why do we leave it till late?
Can we have the mics on, guys? What I might do, since we've got only 10 minutes left, what I might do is take the last two questions and then give the panel a chance to reflect at the end. If you raise a question, hopefully it'll be asked, it'll be answered after the last few questions. So, go for it.
Good afternoon,
everyone.
Can you hear
this? It's not. Now it's working, yes?
Yes, now it is.
My name's Dr. Lorna Cork, and there's also an MBE at the end, and that's important because what it suggests is that I've always straddled work in education in schools as well as in the community. So the MBE was for the work with community groups and with all the kinds of things that we've talked about here in terms of getting businesses and faith groups all together to support and to collaborate, collaborative partnerships. And I'm interested because I wrote a book called Supporting Black Pupils and Parents, 2005, that was published by Routledge. And it's really intriguing to see the resonance between what I wrote in 2005 and what's been picked up by Carol and Dr. Taysom. And one of the things I'd like to ask is, what have we learned since 2005? Everything you've said I talked about then, in terms of some communities being seen as assets, and some people's communities and cultures being seen as liabilities. What has policy learned since 2005? What have we learned since 2005? What can we do now? I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
I'll hold that question. What's happened in the last 11 years? So that's going to be one of our summarising points. Was there one more question? There we go. So we have the secondary education question about nurturing children as they come up from primary school. Question about what's happened in the last 10 years. And
Hello, everyone. My name's Ranjan Sojani. I had the fortune of working in two primary schools within this vicinity here. One Zabi Primary School, which is just on that side, and Mello Primary School on this side. Sorry, I'll just sit down and talk, if that's okay. One of the things I feel really, really proud of in working within those two schools as a community development worker was the commitment of the head teachers in terms of recognizing the new communities entirely in their values, in their religion, in the principles that the family held for those children and their families as well. And the thing that was promoted in both the schools was parent partnership programs. And through these parent partnership programs, the parents were valued for the values, the beliefs, and the principles they held. And so the children were valued as much in terms of the curriculum, in terms of, for example, what Induben mentioned earlier, in terms of reflection, in terms of time for prayer for each religion, and how they would worship in their own religion. And when I see 20 years later on, these young people who went through these schools have now come out as stable citizens of Leicester. A lot of them work in London. They've become leaders in their own fields. They've achieved. Going from these inner city primary schools, they've gone to places like Oxford and Cambridge to study. And they play a really good role within the city and outside. And I just wanted to share that experience with you all in terms of how a good parent partnership program can actually help young people, children and young people. Not only that, their parents who came here from other countries, they actually then went, the parents also went on to do adult education programs, and some went to university. They're now contributing back in the schools and in the community that they live in. And I just feel really proud to have been fortunate enough to go through that journey with them.
Brilliant.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that. There's a round of applause for that. I'm now going to hand over to the panel to have some closing remarks. It'll have to be fairly short, ladies and gentlemen.
So my area of specialism is primary school assessment, and I'm going to be doing my PhD in the transitions between primary and secondary in terms of competition and statistics and that type of assessment system. and looking at the cohesion within Key Stage 2. So perhaps we can continue the conversation over tea and coffee, because that's the idea that the question and answer session will continue there. So I'll defer my comments to that bit. In terms of my closing remarks, I wanted to bring it back to when we, all of us as leaders within a community setting or in a family, have challenges. And at that point, our ideals can often be shelved. And so I wanted to finish here with another quote. Again, I was inspired because we're in this setting. It's from the Morally text. And I think it's something which will resonate across the faiths, across the values, across different sociological theories as well. Do not ever think that this one is never going to listen. This one is never going to follow this path. No. You should become compassionate and continue to give. It is remembered that the fruit of someone's love and good wishes is definitely received. So no matter whether people have good wishes for you or not, your good wishes will enable them to receive fruit. Do not think, I did this much, and yet there was no fruit. However, not all fruits are the same. Some are fruits of the season, others are fruits of all seasons. The fruits of a particular season will only be born during that season. So you have to sow the seed of good wishes. If the fruit is a seasonal fruit, then it bears fruit during that season. Farmers do not complain because a seasonal crop cannot be harvested until 6 months later. And so you should also continue to sow seeds. At the right time, they will listen. Your good wishes and feelings of compassion will definitely bear fruit. If anyone opposes you, you must not let go of your feelings of compassion. Instead, think that the opposition or the insults will work like fertilizer. When fertilizer is used, the fruit is better. To the extent that they insult you now, in fact, they might praise you more in the future. Therefore, become a giver and continue to give to everyone. Not that you will only give to them if they believe you are good. To have this feeling means to be a taker. Do not have any desires for receiving, in that you will only give to them if they say you are good or accept that your idea is good. Whether with your attitude, your vibrations, your words, continue to give. So that's from the 18th of January, 1994. Thank you.
Do you have any closing comments? I'd just like to say it's working. It's been great coming here and listening to everything. Obviously, I've seen some pretty horrific crimes being committed in my duty as a police officer throughout my career. And to see people wanting to come and sit down and listen to how we can come and work better together, bringing that community together, is something that is quite dear to me. So I just wanted to say thank you really to you as well. Although it's easy for us to sit up here and tell us about what we have done, it's you guys that are actually coming to sit here and listen to it and trying to make a difference yourselves. And that is the key bit I wanted to express as well, was thank you to you lot. Thank you.
To pick up on the point that one of our colleagues made, and that is we need to be humble, or I need to be humble, in terms of understanding my own prejudice, which I'm always trying to challenge. And Professor Ron Glass in America really helped me to understand how to get to know myself better, to understand the way that I might misunderstand and misrecognize others. And Professor Christine Sleater has also done amazing work looking at how we can become culturally relevant in our curriculums, drawing on Paulo Freire. And if you go to my website at the University of Leicester, you have my name on the literature, you will see that I have many citations, and you can read my papers, and you can understand the references, or you can read brief summaries, whatever level you want to take it on. But I do want to really emphasise that I drew on Dr. Lorna Cork's research and that book in 2005, and how the change has not occurred as we want yet, and how we can work together to improve that. And if I can just explain that if we develop models for governments to develop policy on, they really need to know what large numbers of people think about these issues and how they operate, which means surveys with yes or no answers. Yes or no answers are quick to address, and they give us answers to problems, but they don't give us understandings of how and why things happen and the values. So when you talk about these primary school principles, we don't have their stories in depth of how they achieved that, their virtues that they brought. And this is why the philosophy of education, understanding the virtues of our cultural heritages and of our heroes that we can really aspire to be like, when we can explore those philosophically, we begin to bring the principles and the values into a curriculum that's standardised through policy, because that's the only way we can really do it in terms of large numbers. So it's balancing those large numbers, yes and no answers, with the rich narratives and stories of these amazing principals who can work with the transition from primary to secondary with parents, with students, and with teachers. Because if we don't work together, we can't understand each other, and we can't recognise each other and develop ways in which we can share our goals of building a community that has cohesion and trust, regardless of territory or national state boundaries. So thank you.
Carol, do you have a closing comment for us?
Thank you, Tim, and thank you, my brothers and sisters in the United Kingdom. This is such an honor to be part of such a beautiful display with such an important purpose. I just want to end on a quote, since my brother also did a quote there, my other colleague. I want to end on a quote that I think is very, very relevant. It's probably very important to your culture, and of course my culture too, is Nigerian author Chinua Achebe. I so respect his words regarding stories. And one of the quotes he said, there is no story that is not true. He also speaks of the importance of ensuring that the world is like a mass dancing. If you want to see it well, you do not stand in one place. And those are some powerful sentiments from author Chinua Achebe, because it's our responsibility to be willing to stand in different places. It's our responsibility, whether we be educators or individual citizens in any particular profession, to be willing to see the world through multiple lenses and to ask the questions. They may not be comfortable questions, but when we ask questions, we show that we care. And that's what I encourage everyone to do. I don't want the audience member who seemed as though she was asking, how far are we, if I recall, the audience member asking, how far have we come? We come step by step every day by having forums like what we're having today here, Tim. That is what we do. We show that we care. It never becomes obsolete because we maintain the conversation. And by having the conversation, asking the critical questions, we can move toward the effective actions, which truly result in the inclusion and the mutual respect that we know resembles what democracy should be and will be if we continue to move in that vein. So thank you so much for the opportunity to be part of this dialogue.
Thank you, Carol. You're even getting cheers here. Just hold before you go, we'll thank you in a moment. Two quick reflections. I think with education, I'm challenged that we need to remember that it's a game of chess, not a game of checkers. That so often we start to approach children like they're black or white and they all go in the same direction with the same behaviour. But with young people and with our modern diverse societies, we have people on the board that have different functions, that move in different ways. Some have more power than others, but all play a role in making that game work. And I am reminded that with white privilege, and I'm glad my sister reminds me of the white privilege that I've grown up with, I have a part to play on that board. I'm not to be removed from that board, I'm not to apologise for my role on that, but I am to learn to play a part alongside the other factors in the game. Second thing I want to remind you, as people of Britain, and I'm a guest in Britain, I met someone from Germany recently, someone very senior in the embassy, from the German embassy in London, and she said that Germany is struggling with knowing what to do with its immigration problem. It's a country that wants to welcome people in, but because they have lost their faith identity, they are lost in knowing how to engage with people that have faith. And while she doesn't believe that making Germany a Christian country is the solution, she certainly admired the Church of England in this country and its knowledge and comfort in its own skin, that it has enabled it to do more and better with the immigrant faiths and non-faith community of the UK. Now, as a guest in your country, I want to say to you that you have got much good going on here. There is a lot of problems, and we have a long, long way to go. But I come from a country that has more ingrained racism than yours does. And I need to learn, my country needs to learn from yours, and to export some of your learning from your academics, from your education sector, from your faith communities, and from wonderful centres like this, so that other countries across Europe and across the world can benefit from what you are grappling with here today. So I want to thank you for being able to host and to join in this conversation. I'd like to invite Sister Indu up, who's going to do a thanks for our guest speakers. So if you'd welcome her to the platform. Yes, can we give one virtually to Carol? Just point it to the camera just over there so she can... there's a camera just there. Yes. Well, you will receive a copy, Carol.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
A blessing for everybody. And so yours is, you remain unshakable in the face of fluctuation. Situations come, but you remain stable and victorious.
Thank you.
Beautiful.
I would also like to thank Bhupen very much, if you could come up, please, for all the work you've done and hosting this and putting it together.
Right, so it's a pity that everything's going to finish now. We wish that it will continue. I'm sure we'll have extended sessions in future like this, and we'd really love to have this sort of gathering again. I'm sure it's... And today I can see that really you have all inspired me, and I'm sure all of us. And it's nice that we're all doing wonderful work. You know, we said that this world is one family, you know, we are one family, no matter where we are. But really, it's like we are all children of God, you know, they say. So in that context, we are one. And I just like to say that really from the Brahma Kumaris, we really thank, you know, all the panelists today for your time, and also all of you, you know, this Saturday afternoon, 2 to 4 p.m., that we had this wonderful, you really sort of brought yourself here. I'm sure you're going away with a lot of inspirations, and I'm sure we'll all be working together as one. But really, could we please put hand together for the panel once again? Thank you. You know, in our conversation today, we and some of you also shared that, you know, we want to see change outside. But like Induban, you know, when she was conducting meditation, she was saying that first we have to go inwards. So really, you know, the activities that we do here, the courses, etc., it really helps one individual, you know, all, you know, to bring about change within. When that starts, when that change begins to happen, then we, without saying anything, our action, our words, what we do, how we, you know, communicate with others, how we live with others, what we say, all that inspires them. We don't have to say much, but what's going on, the changes that are taking place inside. It, you know, it's like you become exhibition. You don't have to say anything. But really here, we do free courses, and we help, you know, the individuals really to sort of re-strengthen themselves. So, you know, as you go out, we have a pack ready, and, you know, like several different events in this pack, and I'm sure you'll pick one that's suitable for you. So before we end this event just now, I would like to welcome you all to have refreshment downstairs, you know, like have, oh yes, and also we have a wonderful literature bookshop downstairs. So some of the gifts that, you know, our panelists have got, you'll find them in the bookshop there, and many varieties there. But please do join us downstairs, you know, for the refreshment, and I'm sure you'll have a one-to-one conversation with our panelists as well. Thank you so much, and see you soon in the future. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, Carol, and we can bid you farewell.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Thank you, Carol.
And good afternoon. Enjoy your afternoon.